I'd like to ask us a fundamental question this afternoon. Perhaps the most fundamental question which the human race confronts in the 21st century. The most fundamental question: will this be the century which is best known, which is marked, which is overshadowed by the triumph of technology? Or will it be the century which is marked by the triumph of humanity? Will we be able to frame these extraordinary developments in technology in such a way that they enhance, engage the flourishing of the human race? That seems to me the question of the 21st century. In fact, one could argue that it is the question of human history. Because throughout our history, we have been striving, toiling, working, laboring to create tools. Homo sapiens, wise man, the name of our species, is also Homo faber, the man who makes things, humanity who creates tools to enable us to do our work. And we can see the history of the human race as a history in which we are able to accomplish more and more and more through the leveraging of our human efforts by hand, by brain, using tools. And this 21st century, in the extraordinary experience of which we find ourselves, our generation, is the century in which there is no question that these tools will become very rapidly faster and faster, more pervasive, more enabling, more powerful, more open to abuse, more open to enabling the flourishing of our human species. So that seems to me to be the question we face this year and in each year of the 21st century. Now, the most evident way in which these technologies are beginning to affect us is a way which is very troubling, which could also be very hopeful. And I want to take you onto a journey into a future which I believe may not be beyond the lives of many in this room, in which we have a world without work, in which our tools have been developed so well that they do all of our work for us, in which artificial intelligence, robotics, has taken the load of human toil off the shoulders of the human species. And essentially, work, labor for money, which we have been schooled into believing is what we must do. Since we were hunter-gatherers and worked in this random way, we've moved toward an industrial society for which we are educated, for which we are prepared, in which we labor to pay our way. We face a future. I do not know how far ahead. I do not know how likely, but I think it is a significant possibility, and it's a significant possibility in our lifetimes in which work is no more. How do we frame this future? Is it a future which takes us to heaven on earth, in which we need not work? Or is it a future which takes us to hell on earth, in which we cannot work? I believe this to be a question which we should be taking far more seriously than we have been. Whether we as individuals, in our families, in our professional groups, in our societies, or whether we as those who influence governments and labor unions and investment policies and flows of capital in the global order. Because I think this is a question which is certainly as serious as things like the climate question, certainly as serious as things like the possible end of antibiotics. These are huge risk questions confronting the human community. We have to address them. Now, to reassure some of you and to worry others, these are not just questions coming from the radical left, who maybe are most critical of technology. Not questions coming from Luddites. Some of you will know the name of Ned Ludd. Britain, my former country, I now live in America, but Britain had the first industrial revolution. And gangs of men went around smashing equipment because they believed it would destroy their jobs. And of course, they were right. And they were led by a man called Ned Ludd. So Luddism is the name we've given for smashing the technology because it will destroy jobs. Now, I'm not coming here to play the part of Ned Ludd. What is interesting And this is really very new. In the last 2 or 3 years, we now see mainstream, centrist, responsible, boringly respectable people beginning to raise this question. So, for example, two MIT economists have published 2 books in the last 3 or 4 years raising these questions and seeing major losses of work because of robotics. The Financial Times had an article, London's boring financial newspaper, on this very question. A few months ago, perhaps the most comprehensive discussion, Oxford University has a center called the Martin Institute. It's its futurist center. It includes, you know, transhumanists and all sorts of enthusiasts for the future. These are not in any way Luddites. They produce a fascinating report which argues that 47% of jobs in America in 20 years' time are likely to go. Now, of course, interesting number, 47%. Brazil is 47% of the landmass of Latin America. You all know the map of your country. Imagine that landmass removed. It's almost half the jobs in the US economy. They analyzed 702 different jobs. A detailed examination. That's what they think. Now, for example, look at the companies, just as samples of what's going on. I mean, look at the news the last 2 or 3 weeks. WhatsApp, bought by Facebook for $19 billion. Do you know how many employees WhatsApp has? It has 55. $19 billion in capital, 55 people with jobs. Huge value. Or to take perhaps an even more striking example, which connects us directly to the old economy, Instagram versus Kodak. Kodak, for 2 generations, dominated global photography. At its height, it had 145,000 employees in the company itself, plus all the distributors and photoshops. Instagram, there's some dispute as to exactly how many members of staff it has. It's around 11. I could not make this up. You can Google it while we are speaking. New kinds of value delivered in ways that involve hardly any human labor. So what I am arguing is that we have a prospect here in which you are essentially removing the human factor, the labor factor, from the value equation. Capital, technology, deliver value. Humans are increasingly unnecessary. And you know the technologies which we're discussing. 3 quick examples to stick this in your head. Google cars, the G cars. California now is allowing these cars 500,000 miles driven, not one accident caused by the car. 2 accidents caused because the human driver got worried and took it over. Again, I'm not making that up. Far safer. Wired magazine recently argued this technology may begin with trucks. Because trucks, the cost base is far higher, they're much more dangerous. This is a far safer way to drive. You know, the Google cars, they have this thing spinning on the top. It spins 10 times a second. Every second, it absorbs more than 1 million data points. This is very sophisticated, far safer. I don't know how many truck drivers there are in Brazil. In the United States, there are 5.3 million truck driving jobs. 10 years' time, 15 years' time, I suspect there will be 0 truck driving jobs. I've actually tried to interest the US labor unions, AFL-CIO, in having this conversation. I drew them into a conference which we had recently. They don't seem particularly worried. I said, you know, the Teamsters may end up, the big truck drivers union, with no members. They didn't seem particularly worried. People think that the future will be so like the present. That's why the future is so risky. Second example, of course, we have IBM Watson, you know, IBM's supercomputer, which won Jeopardy, which made it the very famous, most famous computer in the world. They're now using IBM Watson for medical diagnosis. Diagnosis is what family doctors do. It's the main thing they do. They don't do it very well. Will there be family doctors seeing patients in 15 years' time when you can have a supercomputer and you can have a nurse or you can have a terminal taking your symptoms? Third example, of course, MOOCs. MOOCs, M-O-O-C, massive open online courses, these huge AI-based courses, which Stanford, MIT, are offering experimenting with these courses, in which the key thing is there's zero marginal cost. So basically, you can have 10 students in a class, or you can have a million students in a class. It doesn't cost any more. And one of our top experts on innovation has said he reckons in 10 years' time, 90% of American colleges may have closed. I think maybe he's pushing it a bit, but those are the dimensions. Incredible opportunities for global education in parts of the world where you will never get the kind of capital to establish major universities we have in the West. But not a lot of opportunities for people with PhDs. So, now the standard answer, of course, which some of you are already giving as you get cross with me, the standard answer to this argument is, but people like you have always been wrong in the past. The first industrial revolution since, every wave of invention, innovation, destroys large numbers of jobs and creates even more, and creates far more wealth. It'll happen again. Well, I have to say, I regard that as industrial revolution fundamentalism. The notion it worked then, it worked, it'll always work, that is a very dangerous way to think. Two reasons. First of all, the pace of change. Moore's law, exponential curves. It's getting pretty steep. Ray Kurzweil was being quoted earlier. Genius of a man who believes the singularity will come in 2045 or something when the robot intelligence becomes smarter than us and takes over. I think he's wrong. But this guy is now head of engineering for Google. This is moving very fast. Now, secondly, we had this discussion recently at my think tank, and we had leading it off a man called Marshall Brain, who is a computer scientist who began a famous website, How Stuff Works, one of the early, very successful websites, which he sold years ago. Marshall Brain said, the problem with this argument is that, of course, this new revolution in technology will create a whole lot of new jobs. But who will do these jobs? Machines will do these jobs. That's the whole point. So, you know, Isaac Asimov, you know, had these famous three laws of robotics, or four, because he stuck one on the beginning and called it zero, which are basically all about robots being nice to people. They shouldn't harm people. It's a sort of wonderfully marvelous, liberal, sort of woozy idea. Now, of course, we have drone robots going around killing people. Somehow or other, Asimov, you know, his view has not been built into our technologies. But the point is, he did not add another law which said a robot will never take a job from a man or a woman who needs it. That is the question. So, how do we put these pieces together? I began by saying, this is the greatest question of our century. How do we frame this question? Is technology essentially tools to serve the human race, our humanity? Or ultimately, is technology the point? Are we meant to conform to technology? Is technology going to win? Is a technological model of what it means to be alive, to be thinking, to be active, is that really where we want to go? Are we basically just rather poor robots? We're rather poor computers. You want to get out of the wetware and just into the software and the hardware of this new world. Well, seems to me we invent the wheel. That's a tool. We invent the ads. Of course, in this country where you have primitive tribes still using very basic technology side by side with a highly advanced economy, you see this very clearly. These are just tools. We must frame them as tools, tools to be used in the interests of the human community. It's how we frame these things, the context we place around them, the way we understand what it is that they're for. Now, as we begin to conclude, I have three questions to leave you with. One seems to me to be a really very, very evident. That is to say, we're talking here about highly advanced technologies, about how we will operate when we have robots doing almost all of our work. I mean, they won't be novelists and poets and so on, but, you know, they will try to be, but that's not my point. We will not all get jobs as novelists and poets. Almost all of our work is doable by smart computing. Now, first question is, though, the existing technology we have, you know, we have these little smartphones, which, of course, are highly, highly powerful computers. We accidentally call them phones because occasionally we even use them as phones. We have these things. Now, how are they integrated into our social lives? To what extent do they enhance our humanity? To what extent are they turning us into machines who walk around bumping into people, typing, and in the middle of a date, people are pulling them out underneath the table in the bar? You know how it happens. I see them in the corridors, you know. These are wonderful things, and I use mine all the time, but how do we integrate them into our social purpose so they help the human race, so they are tools for us to use in order that we might flourish as human beings? It's a question for now. It's a question we should be much more worried about now. I think these tools are extraordinary. I wouldn't be here if I hadn't been chatting with Anna on Twitter 3 or 4 years ago. We've been chatting over the years. These tools are extraordinary. We must integrate them into our social, personal lives. Second question. Plainly, this prospect of heaven or hell, of a world without work, is a future prospect, but of course the future, you have to go to the future to make the decisions today and tomorrow. That's why this is so important. What are the impacts of this way of thinking, even if it's just a 30% possibility in perhaps, 40 years' time, however you do the calculation, the risk calculation there, as you do with climate, as you do with antibiotics, whatever the calculus is, how do we use that to affect decision-making now in the policy community, in the corporate community, in our NGOs, among our industrial, how should these reflections influence decisions taken today at the policy level? I think there are profound implications there, not least. We have an education system designed to turn us into industrial creatures, creatures for Fordism, for the factory system. We've loosened it up a bit. We talk about STEM all the time now. It's the same idea, training workers. Now, if when you get to be 22 and you leave college, you retire, what should you have been doing for the previous 17 years? Questions, of course, about income. Socialism says we should redistribute income. This isn't socialism. This is the good of the community from a completely different perspective. Income may have no direct relation to the work you do. Third question. This may be the most important question for you of the 21st century. We began with the question for the human race. Now the question for you. If you never had to work again, if tomorrow morning and the next morning and the next morning you got up and there was no labor involved and you could do essentially what you chose to do, what would you do? What would you do? Obrigado.